We're recording now. I'm Sarah Sims. I am the undergraduate and student success librarian. With me,
hi, I'm Haley Johnson. I'm the government documents librarian.
And also helping us run this room is Randa Morgan, who is the programming and events librarian. And we're part of a team here at LSU that received an ALA grant for the resilient communities showing and grant and everything. And we're really excited today to have Kathleen Benedetto with us. Kathleen is currently a Ph.D. candidate in the Department of Geography, studying hurricanes, rapid intensification, climate change, and population preparedness in the Gulf Coast region. Born and raised in Baton Rouge, Kathleen attended LSU for her Bachelor of Science in Psychology in 2010, and then went to Tulane to receive a Master of Social Work in 2013. But having been long interested in atmospheric sciences and an avid hurricane tracker with her mother since she was little, Kathleen always felt called toward that area of study. And after working with the severely mentally ill, homeless adult population in NOLA for 4 years, she discovered the long-lasting trauma that hurricanes had on the populations affected by them. This pushed her to pursue a course in climatology at LSU, eventually being selected as a PhD student to study under Dr. Jill Trepanier. So before I hand it over to Kathleen, welcome, Kathleen.
Hey, guys. Hi, everyone.
Kathleen's going to present her research and teach us. And if you have questions during this presentation, please feel free to put it into the chat. And Kathleen and I will be monitoring that chat, and we can have Kathleen answer those questions at the end. Kathleen, the floor is yours.
Woo-hoo, thank you. Let's see. Hey, everyone. I'm Kathleen Benedetto, like Haley and Sarah said. And I'm not sure if you all got a chance to watch Decoding the Weather Machine in its entirety, but if you haven't, that's totally fine. I'm just going to kind of briefly focus on a few like main concepts that it covers, and then delve into what I specifically research and how that kind of interacts with climate change. But if you do get a chance after this though, and you still haven't seen it, you should definitely watch the documentary. It's about like an hour and 50 minutes long. It's really, really good. Well done. A lot of really good information in it. So without further ado, here we go. So like I said, I'm gonna just kind of delve into a couple of important topics to kind of set the base for what I'll be talking about when I go into my own research. So you can see the list right there. I'm just going to go ahead and move forward with that. So weather and climate. I know when I was younger, before I did the program, I used to use these two words interchangeably, but there actually is a difference. So when we are talking about weather, we're talking about local short-term events. So we're talking thunderstorms, ice storms, rain events, anything that kind of stays between the time limit of days, hours, or minutes. So that's weather. Climate is a much longer term regional average for things such as temperature, humidity, rainfall, etc. And I kind of have some really cool pictures to depict the two different. So like the one on the right shows observe U.S. precipitation over time and who gets the most. So that would be more of a climate study and climate data. And on the left, you see beautiful, amazing weather events. I'm such a weather nerd. So, but that would be more weather. So to move on, there is also, and I think they discussed this in the documentary, there's also a difference between climate change and global warming. So when we're talking about climate change, we're talking about the processes, both natural and anthropogenic or man-made, that have changed average weather patterns over time. And this can be studied throughout like the course of Earth's history. Like when we refer to climate change, it doesn't necessarily mean, you know, the specific time that humans have been on Earth and have affected, you know, the climate and CO2 levels. For example, some external forcings that can create changes in climate could be like big volcano activity. Like if there's a really big eruption, that could potentially change the climate for the next however many decades. Or like the amount of sun radiation output that we're getting each year, which also does go through cycles. Global warming is more specifically long-term heating of the Earth since basically the Industrial Revolution. So like right before the Industrial Revolution around 1850, then throughout to the present. And this more encompasses the human activities that create this long-term heating, which is for all intents and purposes, fossil fuel burning. I mean, that really is what set this in motion. And the way that people measure this change is through surface temperatures of the Earth. So your sea surface temperatures and your land surface temperatures. And what we found is that human activities have increased the Earth's surface temperatures by 1 degree Celsius since 1850. So that is it seems like a little bit because it's just a degree, but that's a huge change. And hopefully I can kind of get into how much 1 degree really means, because it is a big difference when you involve that kind of in the formula that creates weather and the heating pattern of the globe. So those are some definitions to start with. And then, let me see, sorry, I'm trying to get this on screen. There we go. So I talked a little bit about anthropogenic climate change. That's literally just humanity's impact on the environment and the climate. And I put two graphs here. One, the one on the right was actually used in the documentary. And I thought it was really, really great graphic because it shows, you know, we talk a lot about natural cycles in the Earth, like natural amounts of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, natural warming, and how it goes through these cycles. And so these cycles are shown in this graphic. I mean, you can see the ups and the downs, the ebbs and the flows of the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere. But of more interest is the fact that after about the 1950 level, we've crossed this threshold that seemed to be like what it would stay under for 800,000 years up to that point. And at our current level, we have far surpassed what the normal cycles have been doing. So obviously humans have had quite an impact on our environment. And I also thought that the graphic on the left was really interesting as well, because it could show you throughout time, these are the main players of carbon emissions in the world. And as you can see, like Europe kind of started that 1850 onward, but they've kind of decreased, and the United States and China have really become main CO2 emitters, especially within the last like 30 years. So again, just a little bit of background. Now, what I study is hurricanes. And hurricanes are integrally involved in the climate system. The Earth receives a surplus of heat energy at the equator region. And the way that it evens out this energy surplus, and this is a very basic, you know, explanation, is through heat transfer in different ways, through ocean currents. And one of those ways is hurricanes. Hurricanes are a way for that surplus to be moved more towards the poles where there is a lack of heating. So hurricanes are a natural process. They naturally occur due to the nature of the Earth and how it spins and how the sun interacts with it. hurricanes are what the word that we use in the North Atlantic and East Pacific region, but the general term that's used around the world is tropical cyclones. So basically, what makes a hurricane? This is a little recipe that's, again, very basic. there's a lot of thermodynamic, atmospheric science that goes into this, but I'll just keep it basic. You need some kind of pre-existing weather disturbance. We're talking a small thunderstorm, some kind of precipitation event. You need warm water. You need, like I said, thunderstorm activity and low vertical wind shear. And these will give you a pretty likely chance that a hurricane may develop. But it's important to say that all factors that are listed above are necessary, but they do not necessarily guarantee hurricane development. They're complicated little weather events, but they're really, really interesting. And on the right, there's a graphic kind of depicting the cut through of a hurricane. So you've got the eye in the center, the eye wall surrounding the eye, and then the rain bands that that surround the middle of the hurricane, and they spiral around it. And it kind of shows you, if you read into it, how the air helps circulate and form and keep moving like the hurricane system. So that's the basics. And I thought that I love showing like kind of satellite imagery pictures because I think they're just really cool, but also it just shows how big these things are. So on your left, you've got Hurricane Andrew in 1992. And I kind of wanted to juxtapose that with a much more zoomed in like reality of what happens in the wake of these storms. So humanity is very affected by these storms. They don't just happen separate of what's going on. These storms cause a lot of destruction. And, you've seen on the news, like anybody that's from Louisiana experiences hurricanes pretty frequently. But it is important that populations, especially in the warming climate, better prepare themselves for this kind of event, because in the warming climate, hurricanes, like the next slide says, hurricanes will become even more deadlier. So warmer oceans will increase the hurricane power. So that will up hurricane wind speed. Warmer air holds more moisture for rainfall. So we might see more inland flooding events from hurricanes. And of course the rising sea levels could increase storm surge, which is a very deadly hazard that's associated with hurricanes, especially for people along the coast. So global warming is an important thing to really look into when we're looking more specifically at these deadly weather events. So I wanted to go into some of hurricanes' hazards, just in case, I'm sure there's people in here that don't really know a whole lot about hurricanes, or they know a little bit, but it's good to like go into it. So storm surge is when there's an intense rise in sea level from hurricane winds along the coast. And it causes an immense amount of flooding along for coastal communities. Like imagine a huge wall of water coming in and just flooding through an area. That's what storm surge is. And sometimes I think the highest storm surge measured in Louisiana was just measured from Hurricane Laura. And I think it was like 20 feet. That's a huge amount of solid water coming towards you. And that's very scary and can be very deadly. Another issue is inland flooding. So that's when a hurricane drops a lot of precipitation over a short amount of time. And you've got overflowed rivers, lakes, et cetera. That's really what happened during Hurricane Harvey in Houston. A couple of other hazards that are associated with hurricanes are high winds, obviously, So hurricane force winds start at 74 miles per hour and go on, and they can destroy buildings and create dangerous moving debris, which is very deadly. Like, we're talking like big signs swirling around, running into things, breaking down walls and stuff. And tornadoes can actually be spawned from hurricanes. So we've actually had a few tornadoes hit from hurricanes that have hit in Louisiana. And they're just spawned from that upper right quadrant of the hurricane. It's just the way that it spins is likely to produce tornadoes. The last hazard that I want to cover is the one that I really study more specifically, and that's rapid intensification. I thought, you know, why not break it up with a cute little baby Yoda? Because who doesn't love baby Yoda? To define rapid intensification, very basically, it is a really big increase in wind speed over a short amount of time. The typical definition, what people use in research, is between 25 to 35 knots over 24 hours. And when I did my research, I just ended up setting 30 knots as the threshold that I would use over 24 hours. So some other terminology that I kind of had to define for myself when I was working with this, because it's a really new concept. Rapid intensification genesis is the point where the storm begins its first cycle of rapid intensification. And LMI is the maximum wind speed following the initial rapid intensification. So LMI stands for lifetime maximum intensity. It's just the highest wind speed that the storm reaches during its lifetime. And then landfalling storms were tracks that actually crossed over a site of land following their maximum intensity. You'd be surprised how many hurricanes don't actually like hit land. A lot of them will just swing right out to sea again. This is just kind of showing what I'm talking about as far as the study area that I looked at. It's the North Atlantic Basin, and that encompasses the North Atlantic Ocean, the Gulf of Mexico, and the Caribbean Sea. So I looked at all those different areas. So here are some climatological trends. And again, when we're talking about climate, we're talking about long-term. The amount of storms that underwent rapid intensification just once were 300. So the majority of the storms that underwent rapid intensification only did so once with the threshold that I set. And I'll show you at the end, there were quite a bit that did more than one. So, and at the end, I actually have a picture of the five that underwent four rapid intensification cycles in their lifetime. And it's really interesting the paths that they took. Another thing of interest to note is that the average like maximum wind speed of these storms is far greater than storms that do not undergo RI. And the minimum wind speed is also far greater than storms that do not undergo RI. And the maximum wind speed, again, is significantly greater. I mean, so there is something to studying rapid intensification, especially if it ends up creating a more intense storm in the end. These are just some graphical trends that I wanted to show for us science nerds out there. I separated it into three different year spreads just to show that the trend continued. So 1851 to 2017, you're seeing a really big upward trend of storms undergoing rapid intensification. The same with 1900 to 2017 and 1950 to 2017. So from 1851 to 2017, in my research, I saw a 48% increase of rapidly intensifying storms over that entire time period. Then I also did a frequency trend for storms that had undergone RI more than one time. And as you can see, there also is a significant upward trend, especially even when I break it down into differing years. So I really like these graphics because I feel like they really show what I'm talking about. So these on the left, you have hurricanes that undergo RI, their origin points. So this is where they start. They develop as hurricanes, and there's four main regions that are really important. There's the one out in the Eastern Atlantic, there's one in the Caribbean, and then there's kind of two hotspot areas in the Gulf of Mexico. And then on the top right, you've got RI start points or RI genesis points, and a vast majority of them begin in the Gulf of Mexico. And the RI completion points, a vast majority of them end up in the Gulf of Mexico because they started there. These are also interesting graphics. The first one on the left is depicting RI landfall points. And as you can see, they're very much based along the Gulf Coast, which is interesting. And then you have also your lifetime maximum intensity points in the middle, again, very much centered around the Gulf Coast. And of greater interest is the fact that these storms seem to reach their lifetime maximum intensity right before they hit land. And just as a comparison, the non-RI storms, lifetime maximum intensity points are kind of way more spread out. So it looks like RI tends to prefer the Gulf of Mexico. So just some... Oh dear. Sorry, y'all. Basically, the conclusions of this study are that storms are more likely to undergo RI in the Gulf of Mexico. The graphic cut really quick for some reason. I guess it's not working really well. But those five storms that I talked about that had undergone rapid intensification, they all followed the same path through the Caribbean and into the Gulf of Mexico, making landfall along the Gulf Coast. So I just thought that was of interest. But anyway, that kind of summarizes my research. I could talk a lot about it, so feel free to ask any questions you have. Thanks for listening.
Kathleen, this was incredible. Sorry, here I am. While we are waiting for our attendees to put their questions into chat, I feel like I have a million questions.
Okay.
I would like to apologize if you explain these and if these are dumb questions.
Nope, there is no such thing as a dumb question, right?
Okay, so this has got me thinking. You said this is a new field. And do you have any preliminary thoughts as to why there would be so much RI specifically in the Gulf Coast region? Would that be related to the water temperature? Would that be something else going on?
Yes and yes. Okay. It's actually going to be the second chapter of my dissertation, is kind of asking the why, you know, like, why do we see it in this area? And so what I will be testing is sea surface temperature over time, because like in the documentary, it talked about sea surface temperature has risen like significantly since we started measuring. So I do think that might have something to do with the increase in rapid intensification within the Gulf of Mexico. But also to note, the early record, like any early record, is very sparse. So we might just not have the data. So there might be, and like this is, I'm supposed to be saying this, you know, as a scientist, like be wary of the data you have, but it's the only data available that we have for hurricanes. So we try the best we can with it, but it could be that there is sparseness earlier in the data. But that's why I subset the different years, just to show that the trend continues regardless of how early it started. As for like the Gulf of Mexico, I think that the reason they might tend towards this basin is that it's shallower and it stays warm for longer. So, and it rewarms faster than the deeper Atlantic or Caribbean. So that's just a thought. I haven't like proven that or anything.
Yeah, that makes sense to me.
I hope that makes sense.
I have another question, if that's okay with everyone. I'm telling you, I have a million. We prefaced this with telling y'all that we're librarians. And so I'm so curious, you talk about your research, but I would love to know how exactly you do your research. Are you using archival records? Where are these records held? All of that good stuff.
So really where I get the hurricane records is from a data set that NOAA produces. It's called HERDAT. And some really awesome people like a while ago kind of collaborated and put together archival records of hurricanes and just wind speeds that were measured. And then they used a lot of statistics to kind of interpolate that and make really well-educated guesses as to like the missing data in between. Okay. So that is really what I use. Now, I know that the people that did put this together used lots of archival records. And also, I don't know if you guys have heard of SurgeDat, but it's a program that a graduate student at LSU and Dr. Barry Keim, who's the state climatologist, put together to go through archival records and find all the information they could about surge heights along the Gulf Coast. So I know that they definitely dug deep in the library.
Oh, cool. And Randa just shared that link with everyone if you're interested in taking a peek.
Oh, surge that?
Yeah.
Awesome. Like the shout out.
I have more if you're still up for some more questions. I haven't seen any come in through the. There's one from Chad.
Chad. Kathleen, you're awesome.
Thinking about the research that you're doing, and this may just show my ignorance about how this kind of stuff could be used. Showing the graphs of what the intensification has done, and you know, it's getting bigger and bigger. And it looks like it started in the 50s and 60s. You see that graph kind of go off. Is that some kind of cool multidisciplinary study that could be done with you and some sociologists and anthropologists to really narrow down? Yeah, in the 50s and 60s, we had these huge CO2 emissions that are adding to this. And then this is just the continued effects of that. Like, would that be a possibility?
Yes, 100%. Yes, I would love to do that. Like, because my background is social work and psychology. Like, that's what I started, and then took a weird left turn into atmosphere. It wasn't weird for me, but it looked weird on the outside into atmospheric sciences. So I would love to, like, multidisciplinary studies are the coolest studies because you get all these different perspectives on an issue, and you get to really see it fully developed through different lenses. And I love that. Like, I think the more information, the better, you know?
And I think the social ramifications would be so interesting too. So if you're looking for some librarians to work on that with you, I know a few.
I would love that. That would be amazing.
I wrote down more notes. Okay, so we did the research. Oh, I have two last questions.
Yeah, sure.
I'll go with an easy one first. We're talking about warm water. And I have lived in a bunch of places in the U.S. and have only really experienced hurricanes here. I've experienced one up in New York, and I would have never considered that warm water. And I am very ignorant about other places, but I feel like, does California ever get any kind of, is the Pacific cold? Like, how warm are we talking? Who's got the warmest water? Is it us?
With
the
we show?
We do, okay.
Oh, we do, yeah, 100%, like we do. But the reason that I'm not an oceanographer, but like from what little I have studied, the Gulf Stream kind of, and different like streams and waterways kind of push that warm water to places that are typically cold. So that's probably what you were experiencing in New York.
Okay.
Like as far as the East Pacific, the coast of California, they have had storms.
Okay.
It's way more rare than any of that we've had here. Hawaii gets slammed a lot, but they're also in that corridor of warm Pacific Ocean waters. The coast of California is pretty cold water. So it would be very rare that you would see a storm that would be able to kind of maneuver that way and still be able to maintain itself.
Okay.
Because it maintains itself through heat energy. So if that's not available, it's just going to peter out. Yeah.
That's cool. Okay. Well, that takes care of that one. All right. So I'm learning so much. My last question has to do with, could this information be used in any kind of predictive way? And if so, how?
Yeah. See, that's like a really important question because it's like, oh, wow, I found like this really cool trend that's significant. What do I do with it? Like, and that's really what I'm going to be focusing on in the next chapter. I kind of want to create a formula, if you will. Like, is there a certain, sea surface temperature in the Gulf of Mexico, a certain phase of El Nino or La Nina, and a certain phase of the Atlantic multi-decadal oscillation that produces like the wind speed that would, you know, kind of trigger our eye, you know? So, and I also will be like breaking down those components and like studying the relationships between each one. So to RI, you know, so hopefully that goes well.
I'm pretty sure it will. And I'm going to make the invite official now. And when you are ready to share that information, we would love to do another one of these because, on behalf of everybody, Kathleen, this was incredible. You broke heavy science and do not understand into concepts that are just very manageable and ingestible. And so thank you for taking the time for sharing.
Of course. Y'all are so wonderful. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to share. I like to talk about it. So and my husband's tired of hearing about it. So
if anybody has any last questions, please put them in the chat and we will relay them to Kathleen.
Yeah. No question is too stupid. I promise. Like I've probably asked them myself repeatedly. So like I said before, those terminologies, like it blew my mind when I first started studying atmospheric science. I was like, those are different.
I didn't know that storm surge and inland flooding was different.
Right.
I had no idea. I was just like, water's coming, get out of the way.
It's all water, it's just water.
Well, I'm not getting anything on the chat end, but again, I wanna thank you for this. And I wanna thank everyone attending today. This has been wonderful and look for more programming like this in the future.
Yes, and please, if you guys have any questions and just didn't like think of them in the chat, like while we had it, the chat open, please feel free to email me. I don't know if my email is available on the site or not, but
probably
I can type it in real quick.
Yeah.
If I can figure out how to work this. Great job. Oh, that's my dad. Thanks, Dad. There, that's my email. If anybody has any questions, let me know. So, or feel free to email me. I'll be happy to answer anything. So.
Awesome. Okay. What a great way to start off Earth Week. Thank you again. Thanks to everyone. Have a wonderful evening. And
you too, guys.
Soon. Okay. Bye, y'all.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.